So we need your help and your input to make this what it is supposed to be. I put out cards over there by the water that'll give you the address to send your articles or whatever to, wes@dynamicchristianministries.org, and that way you don't have to remember that or write it down. All right. My Bluetooth is blue, so that means we are rolling. Thank you so much for my technical help. All love. It's the stuff of poets and Hollywood movies and romance novels and popular songs from every generation since music was created. Not to mention the Song of Solomon. It certainly is a subject that has fascinated mankind since he was created. It means different things to different people. Okay, how many remember the old movie Love Story? Uh-huh. Remember the saying, love means never having to say you're sorry? Well, I say love means never having to wear a comb over. I'm not going to make fun of men who do this. I understand it. And thankfully, Danny's got a full lush head of hair there, so he knows I'm not talking about him. But I just want to say that just like a comb over doesn't fool anybody about that bald spot there, I confess I sometimes wish that I had like a spiritual comb over, but it would be just as ineffective as that those little five fingers of hair covering that bald spot. There is no spiritual comb over. But I'm going to start out talking a little bit about what I would call a spiritual bald spot for me. I learned a little bit about myself and my ability to love, or my inability to love, in a godly fashion through something that happened in my life just a few years ago. My oldest son enlisted in the Army Reserves. Now, he enlisted in the reserves, first of all, and second of all, he went into the medical field. Not likely they're going to take an x-ray machine out on the battlefield. However, considering things, how things were going with the Iraqi war at the time, it was the middle of the worst part of the fighting, they were calling up reservists and National Guardsmen who were supposed to stay here and protect this country and sending them over to Iraq. Not to mention the other spots that were hot spots at the time. It got in my mind that there was a possibility, no matter how remote, that my son, 23 at the time, would be sent with a gun in his hand to kill or be killed to another country. He was okay with this. It kept me awake at night. I already had a nephew who had spent 4 tours in Iraq in special forces. American servicemen and women and innocent people were dying every day in battle. Did not seem like a good time to enlist. Don't get me wrong. I was very upset by what happened in the bombings in 9/11. I truly felt sorry for everyone who lost a loved one at that time. I truly feel sorry for the Iraqi people. Sorry that they had to live through that cruel reign of Saddam Hussein. Sorry that they don't know God overall, don't know the true gospel. Sorry that they're embroiled in this war. Sorry that the factions cannot live in peace. Sorry for all the innocent people who died under Saddam Hussein, the innocent people who are dying in the war right now, and those who will continue to die from hunger and disease, which we know follows warfare, even long after this war is over. I've prayed for the end of the war from the time it started. But once I was faced with the possibility, no matter how remote, that my oldest son could end up in the middle of this conflict, I had to admit that I did not feel sorry enough for any of these people to send my son to die for them. I had to face that I was not angry enough or sad enough about the horrible deaths in the Twin Towers to send my son to kill or be killed in Iraq. Maybe that makes me a bad person. I just don't love them that much. Maybe I would be willing to send my son to heal the people of Iraq, to teach them about God and Christ, to spend his life caring for them. But I am not willing to trade his life for one of theirs, or even 10, or even 100. I feel sorry for all the mothers, U.S. moms and Iraqi moms, who've been put in this situation. But to be put in this situation for me was an eye-opener, and it got me to thinking about God's infinite ability to love. So today, let's not talk about man's definition of love. Love means never having to say you're sorry and things like that. Today we'll explore God's love, and I hope to demonstrate that when you fully and correctly understand what love really is, that you will believe with me that all you need is love. So where is the best place to learn about love in the Bible? Well, you might think it's a trick question because the whole Bible is about love. From start to finish, it's a work of love from a loving God to his children. But say if you had to pick one, the Gospels, maybe the Song of Solomon, the Psalms. Any other ideas? How about 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Isaiah, and Jeremiah? Probably when I mention those, you all don't automatically think about love. However, I think the best place to fully understand God's love for us is in these Old Testament books. In fact, 1 Corinthians 10 verse 11 says that what was written down about Israel was written down for our example. And we can learn a lot about God's expansive love for us in his interaction with the Israelites. When you look at these books closely, you'll find that the most dramatic and definitive examples of God's love in action. Let's begin with a section of the Old Testament that covers the history of Israel and Judah during the time of the kings, beginning with the dedication of the temple during Solomon's reign. We're going to read the prayer of Solomon at the dedication of the temple, and if you've got your Bible, which I apparently just spilled water all over mine. That's good. It's, you know, it's wet, but it's still here. Been doused in the spirit or something. 1 Kings 8, verse 22 to 52. Thank you. Although I don't think this is going to begin to undo the damage I've done here. It's going to help. 1 Kings 8, 22 to 52. I'll give you a moment to go there. Now, this temple was a culmination of the dreams of two kings, both Solomon and his father David. Remember, Solomon asked God for wisdom, and he became the wisest man that ever was. Some say that the best example of Solomon's God-infused wisdom is in that incident with the two women arguing over the dead and live babies. And I agree that that was a very clever and smart strategy. But I think we find a better example of Solomon's wisdom right here in this prayer about the dedication of the temple. It's 30 verses long, but I'm going to go ahead and read it in its entirety because it sets the tone for our discussion about love today. So, 1 Kings 8, verse 22. Then Solomon stood with his hand lifted toward heaven before the altar of God in front of the entire community of Israel. He prayed, O God of Israel, O Lord God of Israel, there is no God like you in all the heaven and earth. You keep your promises and show unfailing love to all who obey you and are eager to do your will. You have kept your promises to your servant David, my father. You have made that promise with your own mouth, and today you have fulfilled it with your own hands. And now, O Lord, God of Israel, carry out your further promise to your servant David, my father. For you have said to him, if your descendants will guard their behavior as you have done, they will always reign over Israel. Now, O God of Israel, fulfill this promise to your servant David, my father. But will God really live on earth? Why, even the highest heavens cannot contain you, how much less this temple I have built. Listen to my prayer and my request, O Lord my God. Hear the cry and the prayer that your servant is making to you today. May you watch over this temple both day and night, this place where you have said you would put your name. May you always hear the prayers I make toward this place. May you hear the humble and earnest requests from me and your people, Israel, when we pray toward this place. Yes, hear us from heaven where you live, and when you hear, forgive. If someone wrongs another person and is required to take an oath of innocence in front of this altar of this temple, then hear from heaven and judge between your servants, the accuser and the accused. Punish the guilty party and acquit the one who is innocent. If your people, Israel, are defeated by their enemies because they have sinned against you, and they turn to you and call on your name and pray to you here in this temple, then hear from heaven and forgive their sins and return to them this land you gave their ancestors. If the skies are shut up and there's no rain because your people have sinned against you, and then they pray toward the temple and confess your name and turn from their sins because you have punished them, then hear from heaven and forgive the sins of your servants, your people Israel. Teach them to do what is right and send rain on your land when you have given to your people as their special possession. If there's a famine in the land, or plagues, or crop disease, or attacks of locusts, or caterpillars, or if your people's enemies are in the land because besieging their towns, whatever the trouble is, and if your people offer a prayer concerning their troubles or sorrow, raising their hands toward the temple, then hear from heaven where you live and forgive. Give your people whatever they deserve, for you alone know the human heart. Then they will fear you and walk in your ways as long as they live in the land you gave our ancestors. And when foreigners hear of you and come from distant lands to worship your great name, for they will hear of you and of your mighty miracles and your power, and when they pray toward this temple, then hear from heaven where you live and grant what they ask of you. Then all the people of the earth will come to know and fear you, just as your own people Israel do, if they too will know that this temple I have built bears your name. If your people go out at your command to fight their enemies, and if they pray to the Lord toward the city that they have chosen and toward this temple that I have built for your name, then hear your prayers from heaven and uphold their cause. If they sin against you, and who has never sinned, you may become angry with them and let their enemies conquer them and take them captive to a foreign land far or near. But in that land of exile, they may turn to you again in repentance and pray, "We have sinned, done evil, and acted wickedly." Then if they turn to you with their whole heart and soul and pray towards the land you gave their ancestors, toward this city you have chosen, and toward this temple I have built to honor your name, then hear their prayers from heaven where you live, uphold their cause, and forgive your people who have sinned against you. Make their captors merciful to them, for they are your people, a special possession, whom you brought out of the iron smelting furnace of Egypt. May your eyes be open to my request and to the request of your people Israel. Hear and answer them whenever they cry out to you. There are two important and key points that I want you to gather from this prayer and take forward into our study today. Solomon knew that Israel would stray from God. Probably he'd read Exodus. God knew too. Couldn't comb that over. Solomon asked God to forgive Israel upon confession of sin and repentance, and when they asked for forgiveness. Unfortunately, in time, Solomon seemed to have forgotten this process himself. Eventually, he went to idol worship, from which he did not repent, and Israel suffered for it. What I find so interesting about this passage is that it's predictive, and accurately so, of the history of Israel from that point forward. It predicts both Israel's fall and God's forgiveness of them. I believe this is the best example of Solomon's God-given wisdom. 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Isaiah, Jeremiah, they represent the history of Israel's backsliding, coming to their senses, repenting, and of God honoring this request in prayer. I won't take you through all the details of Israel's time under the kings. However, let's walk through one specific example, and then we'll get an overview of the legacy of that time. In 1 Kings 16, verses 30 through 34, we are introduced to Ahab. Let me just read you. 1 Kings 16, 30. And Ahab did what was evil in the Lord's sight, even more than any of the kings before him. And as though it were not enough to live like Jeroboam, he married Jezebel, the daughter of King Esbaal, close enough, of the Sidonians, and he began to worship Baal. First he built a temple and an altar for Baal in Samaria. Then he set up an Asherah pole. He did more to arouse the anger of the Lord, the God of Israel, than any of the other gods, kings of Israel before him. Worse than any of the kings before him. Not necessarily worse than those that came after. In 1 Kings 21, we read about Ahab and Naboth. You may recall the story. Ahab wanted Naboth's vineyard. Naboth didn't want to sell. Ahab pouted. Jezebel had Naboth killed. Ahab took over the vineyard. Problem solved. Except for that mood killer Elijah. We read about the indictment of Ahab in verses 20 through 24. And then what does Ahab do? Well, let's look in verse 27 through 29. And Ahab heard this message, and he tore his clothing, dressed in sackcloth, and fasted. even slept in sackcloth, and went about in deep mourning. Dude repented. Unbelievable. He was the worst king yet. But then he repented. And you know what? God postponed the punishment he had promised Ahab. Unfortunately for Ahab, this repentance didn't stick. And he ended up with a legacy of evil worse than any king before him. As I said, not necessarily worse than what those that came after. So let's just look at those other kings. If you have one of these, and I apologize I didn't bring enough. It's a timeline, two sides. So take out these and your highlighters if you got one on your table. I put some out there. And what we're going to do, I'm just going to read the king's name. And we are going to highlight the ones that are bad. So just highlight their name if they're bad. Ready? We're going to go chronologically, so even if, you know, they might be on the top line or the bottom line, so. Rehoboam, bad king. Jeroboam, bad king. Abijah, they're in order, bad king. Asa, good king. Nadab, bad king. Baasha, bad king. Elah, bad king. Zimri, bad king. Tibni, doesn't really say, unknown. Let him be good. Omri, bad king. Ahab, bad king. Jehoshaphat, bad king. Ahaziah, bad king. Jehoram, bad king. Joram, bad king. Jehu, bad. Joash, bad. Jehoiaz, bad king. Jehoash, bad king. Amaziah, good king. Jeroboam the second, bad king. Azariah, bad king.
Jeroboam the second,
bad king. there should be on some on the other side. Azariah, bad king.
Where are we? Which page?
Let me look.
Wait, you said Azariah? Yeah.
There could be a problem with, you know, how I'm pronouncing these names. Okay. Azariah's on the front page. The one with the longer timelines. Okay, Zechariah, bad king. Ahalam. I think he's on the second page. I don't see him. Bad king. Menahem, bad king. Jotham, good king. Pekahiah, bad king. Pekah, bad. Ahaz, bad. Hoshea, bad king. Hezekiah, you know what? Maybe my pages are out of order. No. Hezekiah, good king. Manasseh, bad. Ammon, bad king. Josiah, good king. Jehoiaz, bad king. Jehoiakim, bad king. Jehoiachim, bad king. Zedekiah, bad king. All right, we're done. We're going to come back to that in a minute. 2 Kings 24, verse 20. So the Lord in his anger finally banished the people of Jerusalem and Judah from his presence and sent them into exile. So now connect the bad kings. Leave a break in the line for the good kings. You'll have an upper and lower line, two lines. One for Israel, one for Judah, one for the northern tribes, one for the southern. Now, notice how many bad years there were. Yeah. All right, now let's turn to Isaiah 59, verse 1. What was that again? Isaiah 59, verse 1. I don't think I'm in the right spot. All right, well, we'll figure that out in a minute. Remember that Isaiah prophesied during the reigns of Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, and Manasseh. Between the reigns of Ahaz and Hezekiah, the kings of Judah, those were kings of Judah, the tribes of Israel, that's the other group, went to captivity in Assyria. Okay. Listen, the Lord is not too weak to save you, and he's not becoming deaf. He can hear you when you call, but there's a problem. Your sins have cut you off from God. Because of your sin, he has turned away and will not listen anymore. Your hands are the hands of murderers. Your fingers are filthy with sin. Your mouth is full of lies, and your lips are tainted with corruption. No one cares about being fair and honest. Their lawsuits are based on lies. They spend their time planning evil deeds and then doing them. They spend their time and energy spinning evil plans that end up in deadly actions. They cheat and shortchange everyone. Nothing they do is productive. All their activity is filled with sin. Violence is their trademark. Their feet run to do evil. They rush to commit murder. They think only about sinning. Wherever they go, misery and destruction follow them. They do not know what true peace is or what it means to be just and good. They continually do wrong, and those who follow them cannot experience a moment's peace. Things are bad. No wonder verse 12 declares, "For your transgressions are multiplied, or our transgressions are multiplied, and sins testify against us." Well, let's find out just how bad it had gotten at this point. 2 Chronicles 36, starting in verse 11. Zedekiah was 21 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 11 years. He did what was evil in the sight of the Lord his God and refused to humble himself in the presence of the prophet Jeremiah, who spoke for the Lord. I'm going to skip down to 15. The Lord, the God of their ancestors, repeatedly sent his prophets to warn them, for he had compassion on his people and his temple. But the people mocked these messengers of God and despised their word. They scoffed at the prophets, until the Lord's anger could no longer be restrained, and there was no more remedy. Nothing else could be done. Even a full wig could not cover their sins. Notice that the Lord sent them messengers because he had compassion on them, but they rejected those messengers till there was no more remedy. I cannot imagine that any of us would get to the point, and we certainly don't want to get to the point, where there no longer be any more remedy God can use against us but what he brought against Israel. Therefore he brought upon them the king of the Chaldees, who slew their young man with the sword in the house of their sanctuary, and had no compassion on young man or maiden, old man or him that stooped for age. He gave them all into their hands. Those people who survived the carnage were sent into slavery. But here's the clincher. God did not stop loving his people. Let's read Jeremiah 21, verse 4 through 7. Jeremiah 29, verse 4 through 7. The Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, sends his message to all the captives he has exiled to Babylon from Jerusalem. So he just sent them into exile because they were so bad there was nothing else that God, the all-powerful, could do with them. So he sent them into exile. Build homes and plan to stay. Plant gardens and eat the food you produce. Marry and have children. Then find spouses for them and have many grandchildren. Multiply, don't dwindle away, and work for the peace and prosperity of Babylon. Pray to the Lord for the city where you are held captive. For if Babylon has peace, so will you. Here we see God entreating the captives not to give up hope and to seek and pray for peace in the land of their captivity. He's telling them, prosper where you are. And verse 11, which has already been quoted for us today, says, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope." Until I was planning this speech, I didn't realize that God said this to them right after he sent them into captivity. Their friends and family had been slaughtered. The rest of them are all captives. And God says, I know the plans I have for you, and it's not for disaster. It's to give you a future and a hope. Wow. He sent them into captivity, but he was already planning something else. God was still with them in their slavery, and he loved them. And he was busy working behind the scenes to free them once again. I'm a sinner. We all are here. I don't know your sins. Fortunately, you don't know all of mine. But I have not, and I cannot imagine any of you have committed sins along the lines of burning your children to appease a pagan idol. But even if you did, God would still love you and forgive you when you repented. In 2 Chronicles 36, verse 21, I tab them so I can find them easily, and then I lose my tab. 2 Chronicles 36, 21. So the message of the Lord spoken through Jeremiah was fulfilled. The land finally enjoyed the Sabbath rest, lying desolate for 70 years, just as the prophet had said. Look at the connection of all the bad years of Israel. If you add those up, they go from 930 BC to 586 BC. 344 years of miserable behavior and sin, punctuated by brief periods of obedience. And then, just 70 years after there was no remedy, God set them free again. Now let's read or turn to Isaiah 40, verses 1 and 2. This was also written during their captivity. Comfort, comfort my people, says your Lord. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. Tell her that her sad days are gone and that her sins are pardoned. Yes, the Lord has punished her in full for her sins. So I'm done. God was done. You've been punished for your sins. This world is an ugly place. The presentation, if you didn't know it before, that presentation over lunch, surely, unless you have a heart of stone, convince you that this world is an ugly place. Anger, violence, bloodshed, hate, all this stuff is unfathomable to me. I watched with horror the civil war in Kenya. There's abortion, there's rape, there's abuse, molestation of children. Literally churned my stomach, and I'm sure it does yours too. This world's time of no remedy is coming. Mm-hmm. Yet we read a few verses down here in verses 10 and 11, you know, that there's a future of hope. We read similar texts in Revelation, of course, but we're staying in the Old Testament for most of today. God still loves this world, just as he still loved Israel, in spite of their sins and stubbornness. So considering our own sinful state, yours and mine, should we be worried? Nope. We should be careful. We should not be content to live in sin because sin hurts us and those around us. But if we are living a godly life and just falling into sin sometimes, as we all do, should we be worried? No. 1 John 4:18 says, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that has fear is not made perfect in love." I think we are correct to view this, especially in the light of surrounding scriptures, as a call to love our brothers. However, let's not miss that even the love for our brothers is based on God's love for us. His perfect love for us should wipe away the fear that we may have regarding our past, our present, and our future. Why? Because of God's example of his interaction with Israel. Through that, we know that he is a faithful, loving, and tender-hearted God. And of course, 1 John 4, verse 8 says, as we've heard several times before, God is love. But do we get the magnitude of God's love for us? I mean, really? I am not sure that we do. And maybe it's too big for the human mind to grasp. God clearly expresses both his expectations of us and the wages or rewards of our own decisions. He has clear laws. He has clear penalties. He has a clear plan for the remedy of sin in the death of Jesus. Yet we still can have trouble grasping God's love. Mother Teresa had doubts. An article in the Dallas Morning News, and I'm sure a lot of other papers, reported that her diaries she expressly asked the Catholic Church to destroy, revealed some long periods of doubt and a feeling that God was far from or unavailable to her. I don't propose to judge her heart. I do know she cared for, actually touched and ministered to people whom the rest of the world feared to even be around. And I know that there were, based on the entries in her journal, that there were times, at least, when she doubted God's love and when she thought he was absent from her life. You know, she may have had a misdiagnosed mental illness or suffered from chemical depression. I just don't know all that. But I think that she asked for the diaries to be destroyed, possibly because she understood that revealing these thoughts might cause problems for some of the rest of us. Any of us with lesser good works than hers might be tempted to compare our own lives to her life devoted to the most destitute of the world, and think, wow, if God's distant from her, how far must he be from me? And I have to ask, did Mother Teresa really understand the love of God? Shalom Auslander is an author. I haven't read his book, but I read about it. He is sure God is out to get him. His book is entitled Foreskin's Lament. And you heard right, Foreskin's Lament. And it's about growing up in an ultra-Orthodox Jewish community in New York. Auslander's father was a violent man, and so it would seem that the God Auslander came to know was equally violent and angry and, remember, all-powerful. So they say Auslander's book is angry and funny. I guess he has a sense of humor about this untenable situation. In his work and in interviews, Auslander regularly swears at and about this God that he envisioned. He believes in God, and he believes that God spends much of his time coming up with ironic deaths for those who displease him. So since he believes that, and he spends his time cursing God, you can only imagine what he expects to find at the end of this life. I have to ask, does Auslander understand the love of God? Mackenzie Allen Phillips is a lead human character, a fiction person, in the widely popular Christian novel, The Shack. A friend suggested that I read it and lent it to me. It's by W. Paul Young. And even though Young and I have a lot of differences in our beliefs, and so there's differences in the way he expresses things that I did not agree with, in reading this book, I found some very thought-provoking discussions that he outlines about the love of God and how God works in our lives in complete harmony with his love, always. But Mac is disappointed in God. And few of us would be surprised at this. His little girl has just been murdered. In a fantasy segment that takes up the majority of the book, God appears to Mac to help him work through his anger and his pain and his disappointment in God over this horrible event. Mac cannot reconcile the love of God he's been taught about with God allowing this tragedy. Mac sees God as arbitrary, dispensing good and evil at a whim with no plan or no purpose. Would you say that Mac understands God's love? I don't think so. Well, how about you? What's your vision of God? Is God distant? Angry, arbitrary? Sometimes it takes facing the end of this life, the end of your own, or the end of someone close to you, to reveal how you view God. My father died of cancer when I was 19 years old. He was just 45. I was a daddy's girl. This was devastating to me at this point in my life. He'd been an imperfect but totally loyal follower of God the whole part of his life I knew him. We'd spent our lives, I grew up going to church every week, Bible studies, faithfully. We always got the perfect attendance awards. We were always there. We served the church and supported the work with whatever we had. We were not rich people, but everything we had, we were all in. That's the tradition my father raised me in. When he died, I worried that possibly he'd reneged on his faith at the last minute, alone and dying in his dark, stinky VA hospital room. And that because of this, he might have lost his reward. Now, that's a young, spiritually immature thing to think, but I was young and spiritually immature. Luckily for me, I mentioned this to an older, more mature Christian who gently, and in a very kind manner, told me I was being an idiot. And I was. I had not spent enough time in the trenches of life to know God or to know God's love intimately and maturely. When my mother was fighting cancer, just a couple years ago, In the last months of her two-year battle, she sometimes expressed a doubt that her salvation was sure and a fear of dying that was inspired by that doubt. Knowing that some of this, at least some of it, was in part a result of the tumors in her brain that also inhibited other normal thinking processes, we were able to gently walk her through the reality that she had fought a good spiritual fight and that her reward was sure. But it made me sad to think that she would doubt, even if it was tumor-induced or pain medicine-induced doubt. Made me sad to think about it. There's no reason to doubt. If you have sin unrepented of, don't comb it over. Confess it. Ask forgiveness and work through the work to change within whatever little time you have left of your life. Remember Solomon's prayer. Jesus already died for you and for that sin and for your past sins and for any in the future. Don't doubt. Our Father God is a God of love. God is not a distant God. When I was preparing this presentation, I did think about, as some of you might think, Isaiah 59:1-2, where it declares that your sins separate you from God. But looking it up and reading through the whole point, both scriptures, you read, it says, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that he cannot save, nor his ear heavy that he cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he would not hear." Sin separates us from God because we move away from him. Because we put up a wall or try to come over, we move away, blocking our view of him, not because he leaves us or is unable to reach us. I also thought about the scripture where it talks about Jesus dying on the stake, and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus was forsaken, but can that happen to me, I might wonder. Then I recall an incident in the vice presidential debates between Benson and Quayle. Probably you guys all remember this when I talk about it. Benson said to Quayle, "I worked with Jack Kennedy, and you are no Jack Kennedy." So I could say to myself, "Nancy, I know Jesus, and you are not Jesus." None of us are. And since none of us are Jesus, we can't actually apply this unique, once in all the history of universe experience, to our lives. God tells us, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." God's not an angry, vengeful God waiting to apply some ironic death to us. Yes, he gets angry. And yes, revenge is his domain. The Bible says, "Vengeance is mine, says the Lord." Vengeance is God's domain specifically because mankind does not know how to apply vengeance with love. God's vengeance is cloaked in his supreme love. It's grounded in his ultimate purpose for mankind, and it's guided by his mercy. Recall that it says in Psalm 136, "His mercy endures forever." God is not an arbitrary God. On page 125 of the book, The Shack, God says to Mac, in this fantasy segment, "Your choices are not stronger than my purposes, and I will use every choice you make for the ultimate good and most loving outcome." See, we're free to make our own poor, stupid choices, but God is going to use even those for an outcome of love. God created us for the express purpose of showering us with his love for all of eternity. That was his plan from the very beginning. Just like he inspired Solomon to express it, God knew that we would all fall short, and he has a plan for that too. A plan that allows us to get back to that love. A plan, take down that wall, feel nearer to him again. A plan that involved the trading of his son's life for ours from the foundation of the world. Let's examine for a moment the kind of love that's required to do that. Romans 5, verse 7 through 8 says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure for a good man some would dare to die. But God commended his love toward us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Something I was not willing to let my son do. God gave his son to redeem us and to open the way for eternal life to his kingdom. That was his plan from the very beginning. God sent his son to die for you and the Iraqi people. And that little boy, Jamie, the man who murdered his mother, Jesus died for him. And Mother Teresa and Shalom Auslander and Saddam Hussein and you and me. And maybe a lot of people don't get that. But those of us who are the called out ones, we should. In the past few years, there's been a series of books about the love languages, the ways in which we prefer to give and receive the expressions of love, things like gift giving or acts of service and quality time. It's good to know this stuff because it makes all our relationships better and a lot easier. All the languages have the same goal, though. It is to feel the expression of a love in a way that we can best understand and accept it. In 1 Corinthians 13, we find a whole series of love is statements, and we have correctly applied this to how we should express love to others and how we should treat others. But did you ever read it as a list of how God interacts with us? Remember, God is love. He's not asking us to act in a way he doesn't act. He's asking us to act like him. So I'm going to read 1 Corinthians with a few tweaks to it. Starting with verse 4. God is patient and kind. God is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. God does not demand his own way. Remember, he gives us free choice. God is not God is not irritable and keeps no record when he's been wronged. God is never glad about injustice, never rejoices whenever but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. God never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, endures through every circumstance. God will last forever. But prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will disappear. There are three things that will endure: faith, hope, and God. And the greatest of these is God.
Amen.
This is God's MO. This is how he operates. He isn't asking us to do what he doesn't already do. And God only speaks love. No matter what he says, yes or no, no matter what he does, punishes or rewards, whether he shouts or whispers, the only language he speaks is love. In Isaiah 43, verse 1 through 4, it talks again about giving Jesus for us. And it's not my purpose to tell you how to love one another, but my focus has been for us to better understand God's love for us. However, I believe that understanding God's love for us opens up the way so that we are able to better act in love towards other. We all know that loving other people is something we should do, and to the extent that we practice love for each other, mostly we practice it imperfectly. Sometimes, however, human beings get it right. Stephen got it right. In Acts 7, verse 59 through 60, we find that Stephen, while being stoned for a completely false accusation, said, "Lord, do not charge them with this sin." Does that sound familiar? See, Stephen got it right because he imitated Christ. And we get it right when we imitate Christ. Many of you are probably familiar with Corrie Ten Boom. She's a little more famous than her sister Betsy because she survived the various concentration camps that they both were put in and wrote a book about the experiences. Corrie went on to do great things, smuggled Bibles into Russia, I think it was, or at least behind the Iron Curtain. But it's an incident in Betsy's life that I'd like to highlight. In Corrie's book, The Hiding Place, we find an example of the how of living a life of love. Living in a place that could arguably be called the most awful place in all the world, starving, old, and frail, forced to work hard physical labor with little or nothing to eat, Betsy never responded to her surroundings. How could she maintain an attitude of love? Let me read a little passage here. Betsy and I were put to work leveling some rough ground inside the camp wall. This too was backbreaking labor. Sometimes as I bent to lift a load, my heart cramped strangely. At night, spasms and pain gripped my legs. But the biggest problem was Betsy's strength. One morning after a hard night's rain, we arrived to find the ground sodden and heavy. Betsy had never been able to lift much. Today her shovels full were microscopic, and she stumbled frequently as she walked at the low ground to the low ground where we dumped the loads. The guard screamed at her, "Can you go faster? Loafer, lazy swine." The guard snatched Betsy's shovel from her hands and ran from group to group of digging crew, exhibiting the handful of dirt that was all Betsy was able to lift. "Look at Madame Baroness. Look what she's carrying. Surely she will overexert herself." The other guards and even some of the prisoners started laughing. Encouraged, the guard threw herself into a parody of Betsy's faltering walk. As the laughter grew, I felt a murderous anger rise. The guard was young and well-fed, and was it Betsy's fault that she was old and starving? But to my astonishment, Betsy was laughing too. "That's me, all right," she admitted. "But you better let me get back along with my little spoonful, or I'll have to stop altogether." The guard's plump cheeks went crimson. "I'll decide who's to stop." Snatching a leather crop from her belt, she slashed Betsy across the chest and neck. Without knowing what I was doing, again, this is Corey talking, I had seized my shovel and rushed at the guard. Betsy stopped in front of me before anyone had seen what I was doing. "Corey," she pleaded, dragging my arm to my side. "Corey, keep working." She tugged the shovel from my hand and dug it into the mud. Contemptuously, the guard tossed Betsy's shovel back towards us. I picked it up and, still in a daze, I went back to work. A red stain appeared on Betsy's collar, and a welt began to swell on her neck. Betsy saw where I was looking and laid a bird-thin hand over the whip mark. "Don't look at it, Corey. Look at Jesus only." And she drew her hand away. It was sticky with blood. "Don't look at it, Corey. Look at Jesus only. And that is the key. Don't look at the circumstance. Don't look at the people around you. Don't look at the situation. Look only at Jesus." That's what Stephen did, and Betsy did too. There's two positive examples there, but I'll give you just one negative one. Matthew 18, 23 through 34, the unforgiving servant. I'm not even going to read it. Just mention it. You guys know it. The servant had just been with the master. He'd just seen the master's example. But unlike Stephen and unlike Betsy Ten Boom, he stopped looking at the master once he left the room. And how tempting it is for us to be with the master on our knees in the morning and leave him there when we go to work during the day. Because the servant did this, he forgot the love he'd just been shown. He only looked at the person in front of him who did owe him money that he had not paid. He took his eyes off the master and forgot that the reason that we show love to others is expressly because God loves us, regardless of the circumstance or that person. I don't need to go into the details of what to do in a given circumstance. I don't need to provide a chart. If then, they do this, you do that. Nope. All you need is to spend time focusing on the love of God. Spend your time looking through the person and the circumstance to Jesus, directly to God. Focus on God's love for you. If you do, you'll have no other reaction to your fellow man than that of love, passing on God's love from you to them. Let me give you a visual. It's from a movie called The Fifth Element, and I'm not encouraging you to watch that movie. It's an older one. But there's a dramatic scene at the end that I think illustrates the point I'm trying to make. Okay, who knows what the four elements are? Go ahead, shout them out.
Fire.
Earth. Earth, wind, water, and fire. Very good. But the fifth element in this movie is a woman, and she is a conduit for the other four. And in order to save the world, at the end of the movie, she stands in the center of four columns, each of the columns holding one of the four elements. And to save the four, to save the world, the four elements start surging into her. She keeps her mouth shut. She's seen what the world can do. She knows what people are like. And she says, "Why? Why should I open my mouth? Why should I let this through and save the world?" And you know what Bruce Willis says? "Because we have the capacity to love." And that's enough for her. She tilts back her head and opens her mouth, and all that help and healing that's coming into her, it goes out and up. So picture yourself there. You are in the center of God's love. Love comes at you from all sides, surging into you from all directions. And you must open your mouth and spew it out and soak everyone and everything about you with the watering of God's love. You are the conduit. You were created for the express purpose of receiving God's love and passing it on out to others along the way. Remember God's patience with Israel and Judah. Remember how his love ran out to them even at a time when they had rejected him so totally for so many years that he had no other choice but to send them into captivity. Remember the definition of believe that June gave us? Having confidence in the truth or value of something, God believes in your value, and he never stops believing in that. In conclusion, let's read Matthew 22, verse 35 through 40. One of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, saying, "Master, which is the great commandment in the law?" And Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two hang all the law and the prophets." Because God is love, and because the entire Bible, including the law, the history, the prophecy, the stories, the Psalms, and the Proverbs, all of it is based on these two commandments, love of God, love your fellow man. Because God is love, all you need is love. Amen. And because now you're convinced all you need is love, sing it with me.